further ado, it is my great pleasure and honor to introduce our distinguished speaker tonight, Nicanor Perlas. Mr. Perlas received the Right Livelihood Award in 2003 for his outstanding efforts in educating civil society about the effects of corporate globalization and how alternatives to it can be implemented. He's an advisor, global activist, writer and speaker on artificial intelligence, globalization, societal threefolding, post-materialist science, and leadership, among several other topics. He's advised global civil society networks, social enterprises, and the United Nations and Philippine government agencies. Perlas headed global and national civil society networks that were responsible for stopping 12 nuclear power plants, banning 32 pesticide formulations, and mainstreaming sustainable development by working directly with mayors in several Philippine cities and towns. His books include Shaping Globalization, Civil Society, Cultural Power, and Threefolding, which was published in 2000, as well as Humanity's Last Stand, The Challenge of Artificial Intelligence, A Spiritual Scientific Response, published last year. He's a member of the Philippine Senate Technical Working Group on Artificial Intelligence, and in recognition of the global impact of his work, he has been presented with, among others, the Outstanding Filipino Award, the United Nations Environment Program Global 500 Award, and, as already mentioned, the Right Livelihood Award. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Perlas.
Thank you, Sabina. And thank you for the university for hosting this this event. And also to the distinguished panelists, to whom you were here, for agreeing to be in the panel. And of course, the people who came from different parts of California to be here. I would just like to say that given the limited time, I can only sort of give a sketch of what I will be touching on. A fuller and more detailed treatment of that would be, if you're interested, would be in the Summer Institute of the Right Livelihood during July 8th to 12th. There we have 1 week to go in depth into some of the things that will be taken up this evening. And also I'd like to just say something that I would like to emphasize the fact that there are a lot of benefits for artificial intelligence, and most of these are known to the general public. So I'm not going to focus there. I'll be focusing on two other classes of AI. One that has a kind of mixed aspect. There are benefits, but there are also costs. And then also there another company category, different category that deals with the whole question of artificial general intelligence and artificial super intelligence, and what that may mean if the questions there are not fully figured out. So the question of why is the title humanizing? There's a sticker in the Philippines, which is my favorite. It says there, Christ is the answer, but what is the question? It's like tonight. So humanizing technology is, why do we need to humanize technology? So what is the question that's connected to that? Given the limited time available, and I also want to be educated on some of the leading authorities here at the university about this topic, I'm just going to mention stuff, but not fully develop it, because especially the first part, a lot of these are really being covered already, not only in the United States, but also abroad. These are issues connected to social media addiction, social media basically law. I mean, there's increasing epidemics of suicides around the world, wherever I go. It's being traced to a connection with social media addiction, which, by the way, was consciously done. And I met Tristan Harris in Chile. Some of you will be familiar with him. And he started this talk saying, we were at this global conference on artificial intelligence. He said, imagine AlphaGo, it's like one of the most sophisticated AI in the world, which beat the world champions in Go. And said, imagine that computer, instead of being focused on playing board games actually be used to manipulate 2 billion minds around the planet. And so that's why he said, this is conscious. There's a course in Stanford called Persuasive Technology. And so many of the social media people actually took the course and are actually using it in the design process. Mm-hmm. So this is a very conscious thing. and very effective, unfortunately. The Philippines is the world capital of Facebook. and one time I asked a question, what's the world capital of Facebook? And people said, the Philippines, they were very happy. And I said, wow. Because then I was saying that, well, we're the dumbest, actually. We're the most manipulated. Wow. And then I started showing Facebook executives talking about what they did consciously. And including the first president of Facebook. It's all there. It is a very widespread topic. I don't want to go into that. But that's just only one small aspect of the positive. You can use Facebook for other purposes at the same time as this negative stuff in it. So the other areas, of course, are security. Example, like the whole debate on 5G just emerging. People are excited about 5G, but they don't realize it's a part. It's not only that our environmental health impact, but it's part of a larger plan. You need a lot of speed and broadband speed to actually upload billions of sensors in the environment all over the place. To gather the kind of big data, they could have all kinds of applications, including tracking human beings 24/7. So, and some of these applications, so it's there's another positive, negative. But in China, places like China, for example, where there's social control, actually, that's happening. They use the technology actually to suppress Muslims there, and it's very difficult for the Islamic countries to give their voice because many of these Islamic countries are receiving a lot of funding from China. So this is part of the reason why they're basically silent. And this was proven a few months ago in Islamic countries like the OPEC, same constellation as OPEC, met with the Chinese, and there was no mention about the suppression of almost 1 million Muslim minorities in China. So these are kind of dystopian applications. But of course here, you're famous, you learned about, of course, the loss of democracy, or the manipulation of democracy. We were part of that, part of the 32 countries that Cambridge Analytics actually tried to manipulate the election. And Brexit is also somehow involved in the whole process. So this is it. And I'm not going to go into that part of it because of the limit that I'm going to find myself. So basically, the one that I'm really focusing on now is that aspect of artificial intelligence where there's a lot of debate and there's basically no clear solution to the way forward. So many of the issues connected with artificial intelligence, I would say 90% of basic solutions, if there's governance, there are people are involved, and starting to happen here. Example, like there's not increasing talk of regulating Facebook and Google and so on. And Google and Facebook are being fined in Europe, large amounts, billions of dollars for privacy violations and stuff like that. So that part is starting to happen. But the part that's connected with the development of artificial general intelligence and artificial super intelligence, that's the one that's still unclear and needs a kind of global conversation about the topic. And for those who are not familiar, I mean, there are three classes of artificial intelligence. The so-called narrow, it's very intelligent on narrow specific tasks, but not all the human tasks, capacities. Then you have, what they're trying to do is to have artificial general intelligence that can do basically what humans can do. and then ultimately after that, artificial superintelligence that can exceed human intelligence. Of course, there is a lot of debate what that would mean. Is the intelligence on the IQ, for example. A lot of things are being taken away in the definition of intelligence. But clearly, calculations of IQ, of AI, could, I mean, last few years, they have an IQ of 10,000. I mean, just compared to the IQ geniuses, like Einstein, that had about 180, 190. I mean, just purely on the logical, mathematical side of it. And so the general concern there is that this kind of AI is going to increasingly rely on what's called deep learning. And this deep learning is actually a kind of imitation of the using artificial neural networks to start learning, basically from the big data that's given to them, and they can change their own program, and things like this. So in the end, it's a black box. So they're trying to try greater transparency and clarity in this black box, but at this point it's unsure. And this is where the anxiety about this kind of technology is going, because the first part of the technology that we're all familiar with is increasingly dehumanizing human beings. And that's why Tristan Harris changed his tagline, his group Center for Humane Technology. They changed their tagline from time well spent to something broader framing called upgrading humanity or preventing the downgrade of humanity, because they begin to realize all the aspects of the AI today actually result in downgrading and invasion of privacy, manipulation, and all of this stuff, and scraping your data without your permission. So they're trying to create a momentum for creating humane technology. Technology that addresses more what it means to be human. So that's a big question that I'm going to tackle with. So anyway, so the thing with the AGI ASI is that there's the so-called value alignment problem. How can you make sure that this black box is going to perform and is like amazing computing power and speed and all of that is aligned to human values? If you can define what human value will be there, because already the algorithms have guidance against gender, against race, and people of color, and so on, it's already there. So the question is what kind of value, so it's a huge conversation, and at the same time, the technology is moving, accelerating speed, and a recent survey of CEOs said about 85% of them are going to employ artificial intelligence in their business. And the total investment are in the billions. So this is serious stuff and it will accelerate. But the lacking here is actually an ethical context for doing many of these things. It's not clear. Okay, so that I'm just going to skip to that. There are deeper aspects of that. I'll just go to the second part. So we need to humanize technology, and there are actually two steps, the actual humanization process, but before that, a deeper understanding of how the dehumanization or the degrading is taking place. And I would like to just show you, or share with you a quote from Francis Bacon, who, by the way, is also considered the father of digital logic. He already had this during his time, I mean, a few years ago. But his description about nature, he said, we have to torture nature so that she will reveal her secrets. That was the beginning of inductive, it's part of the whole context. So there was no, nature's becoming more of an objectified object that you can torture, you can manipulate. Actually, the beginning of that was for control. And then shortly after that comes Descartes, and also then Galileo first, then Descartes, removing considerations of qualities. And this process continues up to today, and it's becoming more and more pronounced. until finally you get somebody like Harari, Yuval Harari, who writes his book, Homo Deus, where he argues that there's no such thing as human freedom, because in the end, basically, we're machines. You know, our brains created by the DNA sequences, that then the brain produces consciousness. And that's the basic idea in this book. And I'll show you why the conception is not accurate at all, scientifically. But anyway, that kind of thought is also prevailing. And then finally you have the final downgrading of humanity in the form of transhumanism, which is not a dead philosophy. It's very active in Silicon Valley. A lot of tech is there, actually subscribe to this, maybe knowingly or unknowingly. And so transhumanism is the belief that it's okay for the human species. I mean, there are many schools of thought, but the general belief is that the human being is not at the apex of natural evolution. So the next stage of the natural evolution is the superintelligent machine. And we're going to download our consciousness into this machine so that humanity will survive. So it's okay for human extinction to happen, as long as we figure out how to download that machine. I'll download our consciousness to the machine. So if you can see that there are certain kinds of assumptions that are there that when you examine them from the lens of the existing science, there's no basis for it. And this is where I go now to the part of the solution, is to actually, for the general public, to become more literate about those aspects of science that actually negate many of the assumptions of designers and artificial intelligence. And I'd like to start with the biggest one, the reduction of consciousness of the brain. And this is the dream, because basically the brain produces consciousness. But there is a long-standing problem, just one, in the area of neuroscience, where, for example, memory is not in the model of information processing that is used for creating computers. Eric Kandel, the Nobel Prize winner in this area, his specialization is memory. He said it's a very complex topic because there are many different areas of the brain that are involved, not just one neuron, not just one cluster, but they're all over the place in memory. And he said, he's quoted to himself, it could take 100 years to figure out. And then another neurophysiologist says, oh no, it's not going to be 100 years, it's going to be longer. Because the memory, using conventional paradigm, is one of the puzzles after spending decades of these billions of dollars to understand this. They have no idea. And then another development in neuroscience is the discovery of neuroplasticity. And here, I've been trying to check the literature, and I can be corrected if they want, the experts here. And that neuroplasticity is the capacity of human consciousness to change the structure of the brain, the networks that are there, and consciously direct the way the learning process, the restructuring of the brain takes place. So I tried to search the literature, maybe I'm searching the wrong direction, of the connection between neuroplasticity and AI. I haven't seen any literature on that, except human beings that are programming them, machine learning, but it's not actually neuroplasticity, because this is a software change instead of changing the hardware. We're actually changing our hardware through consciousness. And then finally, there's a whole emergence in this area of what's a movement is called post-materialist science, where a lot of neuroscientists are beginning to explore the fact that consciousness is not just in the brain, but it's much larger and it's non-local. So there's a whole set of scientific studies on this. And one of the figures here, the mainstream figure here is Dean Radin, from California, who works as a chief scientist in the Institute of Noetic Sciences that was founded by the astronaut Edgar Mitchell, who went to the 6,000 planet in the moon, and he came back, he had a kind of big experience or change in perception and consciousness. And so he said, we should really start, find out more detail about consciousness. But in general, we are trying to create these machines, but we have no idea that the old concept, it's a 19th century concept, that the brain secretes consciousness. That was a major philosophical argument in the 19th century. And we're still stuck with that. Meanwhile, the science itself is moving, starting to move away from that. But there's resistance, of course. But meanwhile, we're studying sophisticated artificial intelligence based on the 19th century concept. So that leads me to the second point. Although I need to say something because there's something here that happened in the University of California, Santa Cruz, which affected another discipline, which gives an idea of what it means to be human. And that is the Human Genome Project. I didn't realize until I came here that this was ground zero of the Human Genome Project. Multi-billion dollar project over a decade, over 2,500 postdoctoral molecular biologists, involving 20 universities, and the core was being done here. You see Santa Cruz. So it's a center, an area of excellence at this university. But what happened was that instead of proving the new Darwinian paradigm of basically the gene determines the traits, it actually started proving the opposite. Started evolving to that position where what they found out was that the human, they were expecting 150,000.